Have you ever wanted to make your own glazes, but just didn't know where to get started? Making your own glazes is incredibly easy, and I'm going to show you how. We'll start with making a test batch of glaze. Let's make it together today in the workshop. Everyone, I'm Rose and welcome to the workshop. Making glazes can be really intimidating, but once you know what you're doing, it's as easy as falling off a bike. It's so easy, even my husband Matt can do it. You just need a few things, and with all that, you'll be off making your own glazes. We're gonna start with just making a test batch, which is generally a 100 gram batch of glaze, about just as much as will fit in the bottom of a cup. Just enough glaze to try without committing to a huge batch. But if you want to move up to a larger batch, it's all the same process, just with a larger amount of material. Now, to make your glaze, you're going to need a few things: a recipe, some materials, a few simple pieces of equipment, and a test tile. Now, let's start with the equipment. You're going to need a scale, two containers, a spoon, something to mark with that will survive the firing, safety gear, and a sponge. On top of that, we recommend having a mixer, a scoop, a sieve, a brush, a weigh boat, a spatula, a permanent marker, and a 60 milliliter syringe. For most of the equipment, you can use what you have around, but we recommend getting a digital scale. They work better and faster than the old style triple beam balances. Now, we need to talk about personal protective equipment, or PPE. We recommend a dust mask, eye protection, an apron, and gloves. None of the materials we use in contemporary ceramics are particularly toxic, but we do recommend you protecting yourself. Now on to test tiles. You can use whatever you'd like for a test tile. You can cut them from a slab, make them on the wheel, or use a small pot. Anything works. This is what we use for a test tile. It's a slip cast porcelain, and it works really well for us. You can test on any clay body. We use a white clay, but you can test on whatever clay you have. A white clay is gonna give you the most realistic impression of what the glaze is doing without any visual distortion from the clay. Dark clays are fine, but they'll give you a darker background behind the glaze, which changes the way we see the glaze, which can distort our perspective on what the glaze is doing. Now, onto materials. This glaze is called My Blue Heaven, and it's gonna be a cool, glossy blue with some streaks in it in oxidation. And it's Nepheline syenite, 33.1%, calcium carbonate, 22.16%, silica, 40.98%, kaolin, 1.66%, bentonite, 2%, titanium dioxide, 3%, copper carbonate, 2%, and tin oxide, 1%. Now, there are a lot of materials to put together a fully stocked glaze pantry. The materials in our glaze are a really good starting collection if you're looking for a basic list of materials to buy for your first glaze. But know there are a lot of other materials out there if you start looking at other recipes. Pretty much every ceramic supply store will sell materials in quantities of a couple pounds or kilos. The common size for a glaze test for us is 100 grams. With all that in line, we can start batching our glaze. First thing, let's label the container that the glaze is going into so we always know what it is. Next, we just need to weigh out our materials, which is pretty simple. The first thing to do is to put our weighing container on the scale and zero it. This eliminates the weight of the container from the total weight. Digital scales should have a button that says tear or zero. Press that and it'll reset your scale to zero so it doesn't show the weight of the container. Now, gear up with your safety equipment and start batching. You can weigh out your materials in any order. It doesn't really matter. We're just gonna go down our list, crossing off each material as we go. Weighing is pretty easy. Add some material to the scale, wait for the numbers to stop fluctuating, then add or remove material until it reaches your desired amount. You want to be patient and get the amounts as close as you can, but a rounding error here or there isn't going to hurt. After you get your material weighed, move it over to the batching container. Try to get everything out, but again, you don't have to obsess over every speck. And that's it. Repeat the same with all the other ingredients until you have them all weighed out. Next, we need to talk about water. Lots of people like to eyeball their water amount when mixing glazes. No, this is just no. This is one of the best ways to get a bad performance of your glazes. For consistent glaze performance, we need to treat our water like other materials. Every single glaze in the world needs a different amount of water. Let me say that again. Every glaze needs a different amount of water. So there's no one correct amount of water for every glaze. What there is a correct amount of water for your glaze and how you work with it. We generally start any new glaze test with adding 60 milliliters of water. For many glazes, this will be about right. Not too much, not too little. Now, if you know your metric system, 60 milliliters is also 60 grams. And as we mentioned that we use a 60 milliliter syringe, so we just fill it to the 60 line and we are good to go. In general, we're looking for the wet glaze to look like heavy cream when mixed. If the glaze is still too thick, we add 10 milliliters at a time until it's thin enough. Just make sure to write down how much water you add for future reference. There's no right or wrong about it, it's just however much it takes to get your glaze to the right consistency. Some glazes will need 60 milliliters of water and some will need 160. We're gonna put our water into a second container for combining it with the dry materials. It's best to add dry to wet. The other way tends to make the materials clump and not mix well. Now, some people like to give their glaze a dry mix before adding it to the water. It doesn't do as much as you may think, but it's perfectly fine to do. Put a lid on it, shake it up. It's not gonna hurt anything. But it is gonna kick up some dust, so be aware of that. After you add the dry materials to the water, it's not a terrible idea to let it sit around and hydrate, but let's be real. Nobody around here does that, so let's go mix it up. You can mix with a spoon and that's fine, it's just not as good as it could be. Better is a mixer of some sort, as they will mix thoroughly and under-mixed glazes are a problem. We like to use a professional milkshake mixer, but most folks use an immersion blender. They're fine, but just know they don't have the longest lifespan in a glaze lab. You should mix a glaze for about 30 seconds. After it's done mixing, it's time to sieve. Sieves are really just there to catch the clumps and make sure the materials are evenly distributed. A powerful mixer will break up those clumps, but it doesn't hurt to sieve anyway. We like a 60 mesh sieve for glazes. It passes through really easily without a whole lot of force. Some people think you need a smaller sieve, but 60 is all you need. But be gentle with your sieve. We like to use a brush. Hard tools like a spatula will eventually destroy the sieve. Now we'll put everything into the mixing container and then we're gonna mix it for another 30 seconds just to make sure everything is thoroughly mixed. Occasionally, our glaze will have some bubbles on the surface. It's not a big deal, but if you gently blow on the surface before you dip, they'll just pop and move to the side. Before we apply, we're gonna label the test tile with our underglaze pencil. And now it's time to apply. This is how we like to do it. Hold the container at about a 45 degree angle. I go in from one side and I count 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. And then I lift the front edge that went into the glaze first. So one side of the tile doesn't spend more time in the glaze than the other did. Notice that the glaze dries pretty quickly, and that's because glazes dry through capillary suction and not evaporation, meaning the water goes into the bisque and evaporates later. Then I flip it over and do it again on the other side. Lastly, I flip it back to the first side and do one more 3-second dip. And that's it, that's our application. If you're working with a flat tile, we recommend dipping the whole tile once and then half of it a second time. Now, we're gonna make one more tile so that we can test this glaze in our electric kiln and the other in our gas, so you can see what the glaze looks like in oxidation and reduction. Lastly, we look for messes, sponge off any drips, and that's it. We're done with our test tile. At this point, we're gonna load them up into the kiln and fire them up to cone 10. Do watch out for your kiln. We have a rule around here, and that is every time you test a new glaze, assume it's gonna run. So make sure to always put your glaze test on a waste surface beneath your tile. We use old soft brick, so if it runs, it just pops right off. If you're using a flat test tile, we recommend standing it up in the kiln at a 45 degree angle so you can see how the glaze moves in the firing. Then we fire it up. And here we have our beautiful glaze test, some lovely colors and dramatic phase separation. Notice that really the only thing that changed between the oxidation and reduction tile is the color. The effect and textures are identical, but that's something we'll talk about in another video. And that's it, you've made a glaze and you've made your first glaze test. Now you can go and find all those glazes you want to test, and it's all the same procedure every time. If you'd like to learn more about how to master your relationship with your glazes and how your glazes and clay work, join us in one of our online classes or workshops at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com. We'll see you next time in the workshop for more glaze adventures.